give everything you've got. Everything. With all your heart. You'll be winners. That I promise you. You can be the best of the best.
Hey, thanks for watching Numbskull News, and today it is the conclusion, finally, of the superhero movie mega list. This is the best of the best, the top 10. So, without any further ado and all that bullshit, let's just get to the damn list. Start with number 10, Spider-Man 2. It's by far the best Spider-Man movie. Even though I think Tom Holland's a better Spider-Man, still, Doc Ock in this movie was phenomenal. I love the way the tentacles have a mind of their own. Good, there's so many iconic scenes in this movie. And of course you got, you know, Harry's continuing arc as he's developing into the villain and the end. And you're going to notice in this top 10 list, there's no bad endings. They're all great endings. And this one, it may have one of the best endings out of any comic book movie. I mean, just how MJ discovers that Peter Parker's Spider-Man. And now she kind of gets it. Okay, this is why he's been pushing me away. Even though she knows the dude's in love with her. I mean, it was so well acted and done. I mean, Kirsten Dunst was just perfect as MJ. And I couldn't think of a better movie to start off the top 10.
She has to offer onboard computer-assisted memory and a lifetime of on-the-street law enforcement programming. It is my great pleasure to present to you RoboCop.
This guy's really good.
He's not a guy, he's a machine.
RoboCop, hell yes. It's number 9. It's in the top 10. It's gotta be. It's stylistic absurdity. I think that's the best way to describe it. It is absurd. And it's done in a way that's very entertaining. I mean, there's so many bullets and dead bodies, drugs all over the place. Every single character in this movie, these actors are into it. They are bought in. They are chewing up the scenery. They do a fantastic job, like I said, with some absurd plot points, absurd action. But despite all the death and the action and the hell on earth that it's set in Detroit, you know, through all of that, you have this really compelling and sad journey of Murphy, RoboCop, of him being murdered, then being turned into a robot. I'm sorry, a cyborg, you know, losing his humanity. And really the movie, underlining everything, is Murphy's journey to regain his humanity. It's things like the memory of his wife and his kid that continues to haunt him throughout the movie. It's so sad, you know, seeing what he lost and he can never get back. He can never be a human again. But he can recover some of that humanity. And of course, at the end, what does he say? When asked, hey, what's your name? Murphy. That was such a brilliant way to end the movie. So yeah, I'd buy that for a dollar.
You know, someone's dead. They can't come back, can they?
That's what I thought. Are you referring to anyone in particular?
At number 8, there's The Crow. If you haven't seen The Crow, I don't know what the hell you're doing. Stop watching this dumbass video and go watch it. It's the best 90s movie as far as something that really encapsulates what people thought was cool in the 90s, this movie gets it right. It gets the 90s right. Where so many movies was just commercial garbage and crap. Hollywood's version of the 90s. You know, oh, this seems to be hip with the kids. That kind of shit annoys the hell out of me. And it had a great soundtrack. Now look, you had top 40 stuff like Stone Temple Pilots, of course, had a huge hit that was on here. Let's not forget freaking Ministry's on here. It was such a... That's insane. Because people tend to forget that, you know, there's all kinds of genres of rock and heavy metal that exploded in the 90s. Stuff that you never heard of. All kinds of new genres. I mean, Nine Inch Nails is on this, and it's not one of their huge hits. You know, but it was the perfect song and sound for this movie. Unfortunately, what helps is the tragic death of Brandon Lee has really made this movie iconic. Much like the death of Kurt Cobain really propelled Nirvana into this godlike tier. They were always going to be an important band, but we never got to see the bad album Kurt Cobain was going to do. That was, of course, the sad part. We never got to see him really launch. This movie was going to really catapult Brandon Lee into the stratosphere. And really, if you think about it, a few years later, if Brandon Lee had not been killed, he probably was going to be an option for the Matrix as Neo. I could see that. He would have been perfect. Now, I love Keanu Reeves. Got no issue with him at all. He was part of what made those movies great. But just think about it in your heart of hearts. Brandon Lee may have been pretty damn good, too.
Mr. Stark, you've been called the Da Vinci of our time. What do you say to that?
Absolutely ridiculous. I don't pay him.
What do you say to your other nickname, the Merchant of Death?
That's not bad.
They say the best weapon is one you never have to fire. I prefer the weapon you only need to fire once. That's how Dad did it. That's how America does it. And it's worked out pretty well so far. To peace.
Number 7, and of course Iron Man has to be on the list. It's the movie that jump-started the MCU. Not to mention it reinvigorated Robert Downey Jr.'s career. And I was skeptical as hell. I remember when I saw the first trailer. It was, really? You're gonna go with some B-level guy, Iron Man? I mean, it annoyed me. I was like, are y'all running out of ideas already? You know, it seemed like the comic book genre really kind of, you know, popped off in 89 with Batman and then was killed off by Batman, you know, and really kind of got jump-started again with the X-Men and Spider-Man. But, you know, the Fantastic Four were good, and of course Superman Returns was a big piece of shit. So when I saw this, you know, I was like, okay, we're right in the midst of seems like it'd be a really great Batman trilogy, and you're coming out with freaking Iron Man? I mean, it's like, what the hell are you doing? I saw it, and I was freaking blown away. I couldn't believe how good this was. And someone had told me to, you know, hey man, there's something after the credits, you gotta check it out. So I stayed after the credits, and I'm like, here's Sam Jackson. I'm like, what the hell is he doing in some little after credits scene? This dude's a superstar. Dude, what's he wasting his time for? I'm like, it kind of puzzled me. Then he introduced himself as Nick freaking Fury, and I'm like, holy shit, they're going to have S.H.I.E.L.D.? They're going to have Nick Fury? You know, I'm thinking of like Iron Man 2 and all that. I'm like, that's going to be huge. But when he said Avengers Initiative, I was like, oh, I think I was in the theater, and I was like, fuck, like loud. I just couldn't believe. And they followed through. I mean, but this movie's damn good, man. Damn good. It's the best origin story ever.
Why are you looking at me like that?
There are two reasons why I'm looking at you like this. One, because it seems you are the only survivor of this train wreck. And two, you don't have a scratch on you.
At six, and you know what? Y'all probably even forgot about this. But Unbreakable. Unbreakable. Now, why is it in my top 10? Other than it being a great freaking movie, but it did for the comic book genre as The Unforgiven did for the Western. It brought that, it kind of broke things down, really peeled back the layers. So in this Unbreakable setting, you're in the regular world. There's no super people. There's no super villains. It's just regular old freaking life. You get an idea put in your head that, hey, this guy survived something that, how the hell can you survive that? He's got to be a super special person. So the whole time, it's such an interesting journey of Bruce Willis thinking that's a bunch of dumb shit to slowly but surely, like, man, maybe this is me. You know, maybe. And his son is so cool. He wants to see his dad be this freaking Superman kind of guy. And of course, Sam Jackson in this is phenomenal. He's so good in this. And it really shows his range as an actor. He's usually like some kind of a badass or something. But here, you know, he's a more of a subdued character, you know. And he's not big and brash and boastful like we all love Samuel Jackson to be. He's very methodical. And that was an interesting character for him to do, and he did great despite the freaking weird ass haircut, but it works for the character. Now you may be wondering, okay, why did you leave Split or Glass off the list? You know, off this mega list. To me, Split that's not a superhero movie. It's not. I mean, they shoehorn Bruce Willis at the end of it, like, oh shit, but it's kind of not really. And Glass, it didn't have that feeling of being any type of superhero movie to me. Neither one of them did. So I excluded them.
So many battles waged over the years. And yet, none of them like this. Are we destined to destroy each other? Or can we change who we are and unite? Is the future truly set?
X-Men Days of Future Past, by far the best X-Men movie. I mean, it's not even close. You might be asking yourself, number five, though? You know, right there in the middle of the top 10? For me, the X-Men, that is my, above anything else, that's my favorite comic, favorite cartoon. I grew up passionately loving that. So many people love Spider-Man or Superman or Batman. X-Men, that was my shit. That was my jam. Best storylines. Really how the entire X-Men universe is kind of allegorical to the civil rights movement. I mean, there's some depth in these comics you don't get with other stuff. You don't get with other comics. Subject matters like, you know, Klan or neo-Nazi type groups hunting down mutants. You know, that kind of shit. With religious fervor, you know, people realizing, you know, maybe there are some good mutants and not just bad mutants. I mean, they covered a lot of ground in the X-Men, and that's why I always appreciated it. But this movie in particular, because I liked the first X-Men movie, I really liked the X2, but X3, oh, what an abortion, what a piece of shit. They just killed the franchise and really stripped away everything that makes X-Men great and just screwed it all up. And this was just a great way to redo it. And not only that, but combine the old and the new cast. It's like what they try to do with Star Trek Generations, except this movie actually did it well. And we finally got Sentinels. Son of a bitch. It took four movies, actually at that point, five X-Men movies to finally get a damn Sentinel. But we got them, and they were good. They were really good. And Nimrod, I didn't think they'd ever do Nimrod, even though they changed the look of them and everything, they did a great job, man. I was intimidated by this freaking robot. I was like, this thing's going to kill us all. It's going to come out of my TV and kill me. Such a great, great ending. And you can tell. They're like, you know what? That X3 ended like dog shit. The whole thing was dog shit. I'll tell you what, X-Men fans, we're going to give you an ending that you deserve. And that's what they gave me.
There was an idea to bring together a group of remarkable people. So when we needed them, they could fight the battles that we never could.
Gentlemen,
what are you prepared to do?
No offense, but I don't play well with others.
Big man in a suit of armor. Take that away, what are you?
Genius, billionaire, playboy, philanthropist.
At number four, the Avengers. I never thought I'd see the day. I mean, none of us did. And this thing was so freaking good. Even people who aren't into superhero movies, they know this thing's good. The writing was so fantastic. I mean, everyone got a chance to shine. Even Hot Guy got moments in this movie. But this has to be high up on the list because it shows everybody what's possible when it's done right. DCEU. If you have patience and you have some creativity, you got a great property, you got great characters, if you're just willing to pay the price and build this thing up slowly, you can have something great. And this was great. I was a little worried. I didn't know if they could pull it off, but I was more excited than anything. And this movie doesn't let you down at all. The only bitch I've ever heard about it was the theme music. And you remember back then, back in 2012, 2013, people were kind of shitting on the Avengers theme. You know, like it was like basic and boring and, you know, just generic. And now it's just iconic, legendary theme, you know. It's like when we went to the theaters, or when you saw the trailers, especially the trailers for like Infinity War and Endgame. I mean, you got goosebumps and chills when you heard that shit. I just love how things change over time, especially when the greatness has been revealed.
You've changed things. Forever. There's no going back. See, to them, you're just a freak. Like me.
At number three, and this may be the only list that anyone ever does that has The Dark Knight not in the top spot. It's not even in the top two, folks. It's number three for me. Now, let's don't get it twisted. As far as a single, solitary hero, this is a Batman movie. All right, so think of any character, comic book character, ever done, ever, you know, ever had a movie made on him. Dark Knight beats them all. And it does it by a lot. I'm not going to waste a ton of time telling y'all what's great about The Dark Knight. You know, I mean, that's why we always see it number one all the time. From the characters. Who thought the freaking joke? I mean, come on. I got to say this, though. When this movie first came out, I didn't want to see it. Because I was like, no one could be the Joker except for Jack Nicholson. I was like, screw Heath Ledger. Until I saw it, and then I was like, son of a bitch, he's even better. You know, I don't have to tell you about the arc of Two-Face. I don't have to tell you about the music, the score, you know, the mood of the movie. Everything was done phenomenally well. Just so well written, so well acted, so well directed. I know what you're saying. Well, shit, why ain't it number one then? Well, I'll tell you why.
In time, you will know what it's like to lose. To feel so desperately that you're right, yet to fail all the same. Dread it. Run from it. destiny still arrives.
Number two, Avengers Infinity War, which means, of course, we'll get to number one in a minute, but you know who it is, what it is already. And the reason The Dark Knight cannot be number one for me is because of the greatness of Infinity War followed by Endgame. It's a two-part that hits hard, hits so hard. In Infinity War, we finally get Thanos. And Josh Brolin, fantastic, phenomenal job. He didn't look fake, you know. He didn't look like some DC shit. You know, he didn't look like that fake-ass peckerhead that's in the Justice League, you know. He looked intimidating. He looked real. It looked like a real actor doing a really good job. We got a lot of Thanos in this. I didn't think we were going to get that much. But we did. I mean, it was his story. And the dude freaking wins. I mean, all of us. I mean, at the end of this movie, you're like, oh my God, people are dusting off. What the hell? And Gamora's freaking dead. What? You know, we're all freaking out here. And the battle scenes are just insanely good. The end scene of Wakanda. God, that was so great.
Whatever it takes. I like this one.
So when you follow up Infinity War with Endgame, dude, that's why these movies are one and two for me. Because I didn't know where the hell, I'm like, where are you going to go after Infinity War? How is this going to resolve? I mean, everyone had their theories, but how the hell are you going to make this not suck? And the fact that the key to everything was freaking Ant-Man was beautiful. It was beautiful, because I love Ant-Man, but you don't think of him as a guy that's going to come in with the plan or the piece of technology or whatever that's going to save the universe, but the dude does. And this movie's got all kinds of great callbacks from other movies. I mean, talk about 21 other movies. It brings in shit from all over the place. And the fan service was phenomenal. And I'm sorry, at this point, that's what these two movies are all about. Infinity War with Endgame. Fan service, payoff. You know, it's the people like from Game of Thrones that couldn't figure that out shit out. The guys who wrote Lost couldn't figure it out. Sons of Anarchy. There's so many great TV shows with great writers that couldn't figure out to serve your fans. What I appreciate above all is Marvel was not, I mean, they were determined to not disappoint you. They were going to give you everything. I mean, Easter eggs galore. I mean, these are what superhero movies were always supposed to be. And I know, look, The Dark Knight, forget genre. It's a great movie. It's a solo movie. It's probably somewhere of all time. It has to be in my top 10, maybe top 20. But it is so good. I'm not trying to kill anyone for thinking anything else. But this is a superhero movie mega list. And no movie, and I mean no movie, has more superheroes in one fucking battle than Endgame. And it was an outstanding battle. I mean, think about it. 22 movies and on the 22nd movie, at the end, we finally get Avengers Assemble. They know how to do it right. You don't just uncork the shit right from the jump. You build up nice and slow. And then you give us what we want. And what we want is every freaking hero on the same battlefield fighting the bad guy. And who's the bad guy? One of the great villains of the entire Marvel Universe, Thanos. And he was exquisite. He was awesome. He was everything we wanted. ultimate badass. Endgame was the perfect ending to that beginning of the MCU. That I know it's phase 1, 2, and 3 put together, but really it's like one chapter, if you will, so far in the history of the MCU. You know, having to say goodbye to Tony Stark and Steve Rogers, those were tough ones, man. That's what really sets apart Endgame from everything else. Because they give you all the fan service, they give you all the excitement and the drama, everything we come to love of Marvel, and then they hit you with that Tony Stark sacrifices himself for the team. And if you recall, it's something Steve Rogers said that he could never do, that he never had that in him, and turns out he was the big hero. And then the way they ended Steve Rogers' story was, it was perfection. Because you go back to the first Avenger and how sad, you know, how sad his story is. And it's been sad throughout the whole way, just how he lost everything. And finally at the end, he's like, you know what, we won the war. I'm going to do a little something for myself. I'm going to go back and have my life. It was so great. Because it doesn't screw up the whole future, right? It doesn't screw with anything. It just creates an alternate timeline. So he's not screwing nothing up over here. If you had to say goodbye to those characters, they really found, I thought, the perfect way to end it for both of them. The only concern it leaves me with is, where the hell are you going to go from there? I mean, the MCU, that's a high freaking mountain to have to try to climb again. That's like scaling Everest. You live, you take your selfie, you get back down. You didn't lose any fingers or toes, and you're still alive. And now Marvel is at the base of the summit again, trying to get back up there. That's going to be tough as hell. I mean, I'm rooting for him, but this, you know, like I said, the first three phases of the MCU have been nothing short of brilliant. And it's just going to be hard to recreate that magic. Anyway, that's my list. I'm finally freaking done with it. And for the one or two people who watched any part of this, thank you so much. If you're the one person that may, I don't know if one person's watched all of them. Maybe my daughter, I don't know. But if anyone years from now, you know, 10 years from now, stumbles upon this and is just bored and you watch the whole thing, thank you. I appreciate that very much. But regardless of the quality, I'll be back with some other crap later. Thanks for watching. Bye.